More and more children are out of school, but parents don't want math learning to stop. They're turning to Mathnasium at home. Real-time math instruction tailored to your child's exact educational needs. It's the same face-to-face live instruction used in our centers for over 15 years, now on a computer. Your child can keep their math skills sharp, catch up, or soar ahead, from home or anywhere with an internet connection. To learn if Mathnasium at home is right for your child, visit mathnasium.com/at home. Mathnasium at home, changing lives through math.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Mathnasium Schoolhouse. I am John, the AVP of Education and Training for Mathnasium, and I am super excited to have you all with me today talking about mental math again. This is the fourth one that I've done with you if you've joined me before. And if you're new, don't worry too much. Some of the things that we're going to talk about today, I've touched on before, but some of it will be new. And so I'll kind of walk you through it and you'll be able to catch up. As always, I provided a worksheet for you to follow along with me. And I think, it's always a good idea to, maybe watch it again later and revisit some of the things that we discussed. Even though today's lesson is on mental math, you can certainly write things down. I will write things down too. And it's a reminder of what might be going on in your brain as you're thinking about some of these problems mentally. And when you come to Mathnasium, it's really cool because we put together a list of topics for you to work on and practice. But there's times when we are going to focus on number sense and really encourage mental math, because that's when math is really fun. And, that's one of the things we focus on at Mathnasium. So it's one of the topics that I like to share with you all, one that I like doing with the schoolhouse. And, as always, I'm really excited. We're going to focus mostly on multiplication and division today. And when I say that, we're really going to be focused on concepts related to multiplication and division and halving and doubling. So if you are good with doubling numbers, finding halves of numbers, then you'll be able to follow along. And like I said, the only thing that I always ask is for you to, just work hard and do your best. And these are things that you can continue to practice. If you're a parent, when you look at the worksheet that I provided, and I'll also provide you one after the lesson, you'll get more exercises and you'll be able to create some of your own. And, because they're mental math questions, you'll be able to ask your child it's really good in that way. So, like I said, you can use a pencil and paper if you want, but I really encourage you to try your best and think about these all up here, and we'll stretch your brain just a little bit today. So with all of that said, let's move into today and talk about, we'll just start with a little warm-up question. So if I asked you what 99 times 7 is, and remember we're going to focus on doing it mentally. And as always, you can type your answers in the comments. Feel free to share some of the ways that you may like to look at these problems. Introduce yourself. If you go to a Mathnasium, love to know what Mathnasium you go to. If you're in a Mathnasium right now, doing a little watch party, be sure to introduce yourself too. It's great to see you all back again with me. So 99 times 7, and a lot of what we've talked about with mental math is trying to connect it to numbers that are friendlier, okay? And when you start looking at math problems like this and looking for numbers that may be a little friendlier for you, where the mental math may be easier, what we want is your brain to go in that direction first. And I've talked with you about this before, that you have to be able to do things like I just wrote. They're important for school. They're important for you to progress. But when you see problems like this, I want you to shift your focus just a little bit and think about how can I do this all up in my head. We know that 99 is really close to what number? It's very close to 100. So I'm thinking 100 times 7, and that's not so bad. That's 700. But that's too much. I wanted to know what 99 times 7 is, not 100 times 7. And I have one too many 7s. I need to take away one 7 from 700. So now all I have to do up here is 700 minus 7, and I get 693. And the cool thing about this is that if I were to ask you what 98 times 7 is, for example, think about how that would change. So instead of subtracting one 7, I would have to subtract two 7s, or 14. Things for you to practice. 97 times 7. 96 times 7. Okay? So let's do another one that's exactly like it, like I like to do. So we talk about a rule, and then usually I will ask you to try one that's a lot like it. So let's take a look at 99 times 4. Now, if you joined me previously, we talked about if you want to multiply something times 4, you can double that number and double it again. That's one way you could do it. If you got 396, you're correct. Okay. So there's a few different ways to look at this one. The way we just talked about, 100 times 4 is 400. Take 4 away, you get 396. I mentioned if I want to multiply something by 4, I can double it and double it again. If you double 99, you get 198. And you double that again, you get 396. That's another way to think of it. Some of you may even think about this as 90 times 4 plus 9 times 4. Remember, there's always multiple ways to look at this, and you have to find the one that you're most comfortable with. Now, 99 is really close to 100, and I would suggest that way, but maybe some of you like that way. It works too. So just a few different ways to look at something like that. Okay. All right. So if you're following along on the worksheet, you know that I'm going to up the difficulty just a little bit here. Okay. So let's take a look at 99 again, but let's look at 99 times 18. So I'll give you a moment. Okay, so what was your first step? Remember, we're thinking 99 is really close to 100. So if you want to do 100 times 18 mentally, that's not so bad. Just take 18 and add two zeros to it. You get 1,800. But I need to take 118 away. I don't want to know what 118s or 118 times is. I want to know what 99 of them are. I need to take 118 away. You should get 1,782. Okay. Now it's the same thing we just talked about. You could take 98 times 18, 97 times 18, and for every one of those, I need to take another 18 away. So if I were to ask you what 96 times 18 is, then I know I need to take away four 18s, which is 72, and I can solve it that way. So different problem, but the same idea. And once you start getting comfortable with this, then all of these, you can do them pretty well. And it really wasn't anything more than just subtracting a two-digit number from 1,800, which isn't so bad. Okay. You also can think of this as being 99 times 9. Okay. And then you can double that. So 99 times 9 is 891, and you can double that, and that gives you 1,782 as well. Maybe you like to think of it that way. When you look at math problems and they don't make sense because you're not sure where to start, there's always multiple ways to start a problem, and some are better than others. And this is the exact same way. When you practice things like this, you practice your problem solving. Your problem solving will get better if you look at a problem like this and try to find more than one way to solve it. In some ways you like, in some ways you don't think are very good, and that's okay. It's worth practicing. Okay? Awesome. All right, let's move on to something a little bit different. Get away from the 99s for a moment. Let's talk about something like 640 times 50. So we kind of, a moment ago, focused on a rule on how to deal with 99s or 98s or even 97s for that matter, and stuff that you can practice. But I kind of want to focus on multiplying times 50, okay? Now at Mathnasium, and maybe you've learned this at Mathnasium or maybe somewhere else, when we want to multiply something times 5 until we learn our 5's facts, you can multiply it times 10 and cut it in half. Okay, so let's look at something that's kind of close to this. So if I were to ask you what 17 times 5 is, let's just say. And that's, you don't really learn your 17s facts. Even if you are really good with multiplication, maybe you don't learn your 17s. You just have a way to get there. Well, we talk about how you can multiply times 10 first, and then I can cut that in half to get my 5s facts. Okay. So the idea here is still the same. Except instead of 10 and 5, I want to think of this as being 150. So one way you can do this is to take this number and multiply it times 100. So what's an easy way to multiply something by 100? So if I want to multiply something by 100, let me erase some of this here. If I want to multiply something by 100, I can take that and I can add two zeros. Okay, so I'm thinking mentally. So 640, I want to multiply times 100, I add two zeros, and I get 64,000. But if I really wanted to multiply by 50, all I have to do is take this and cut it in half. Well, half of 64,000, half of 64 is 32, and I have three zeros. Are there any other ways that you could have looked at this? You can type it in the comments and share. Some of you may be saying it might have been simpler to just not think about the zeros. And you're right. You can think of it that way too. 64 times 5 is 320, and I just have to add back in the zeros that I took away. And I get 320,000. Sorry, 32,000. So let me ask you a question. If the way I solved that was to multiply by 100 first and then cut that in half, do you think that the opposite would work? Could I take this and cut it in half first and then multiply times 100? And the answer is yes. If I cut 640 in half, half of 640 is 320, times 100 is 32,000. Now, it gets a little bit weird if you cut in half first. It will always work. But think about what might make this tricky to cut it in half first before you multiply times 100. If that's an odd number, then you have to deal with a fraction. Or maybe you're good with decimals and it's not so bad. But if that's an odd number, then cutting it in half first might be a little bit tricky. Okay, and you would have to practice that a little bit. Okay. Let's do another kind of like that. So I have 262 times 50. I'll give you a moment to... So on this one, if you got 13,100, awesome. And think about the two ways that you could look at that. One way is to multiply times 100 first, then find half. Or you could do the reverse, which is find half, then times 100. The first way, you would get to 26,200. You'd have to cut that in half. The second way, you'd find half of this first, which is 131, then times 100 is two more zeros. And remember, this way works pretty well as long as that's even. If it's odd, again, you can do it. It's just you get a fraction you have to kind of deal with here, okay? Let's take a look at one that does have an odd number in front. So how about 145 times 50? So remember, you're thinking, especially if it's an odd number, you want to multiply times 100 first. And that gives you 14,500. Okay. Then all you have to do is cut that in half. And there you go. Just things for you to practice. You keep practicing, it's going to take more than just a couple of problems to get it, but you start looking at things like that, and you start thinking, okay, times 100, cut it in half. Times 100, cut it in half. And eventually, you'll be able to get somebody to give you a huge number, and you'll be able to do that. Okay, awesome. If you're following along in your worksheet, you notice that I made it even bigger. So now you're thinking, okay, well, probably before you started this, you were thinking, there's no way I'm going to be able to multiply something times 500 in your head, some of you. But if you practice, you'll definitely get it. Okay. So it's not 50 anymore, it's 500. So let's... let's see what you get. If multiplying times 50 was, I want to multiply by 100 first and cut in half, then what do you think times 500 would be? I want to take this and multiply it times 1,000, which means add three zeros. and then cut that in half. 92,000. And if you're thinking, well, finding half of 184,000 is really hard, well, remember, you can think of it as what's half of 184. And then that's 92, and then add the three zeros back in. So something for you to practice. Times 5, times 50, times 500, times 5,000, and see how far, how high you can go. And then show everyone you know. Okay. Teach someone these tricks. Okay. Let's shift gears a little bit to division. Okay. Now, if you joined me before, we've done problems that are like this, and I want to just revisit this idea again. So, if I want to multiply by 8, I can double, double, and double again. If I double a number 3 times, that's the same as multiplying by 8. So then what do you think dividing by 8 is the same as? Dividing by 8 is the same as cutting this in half, in half again, and then in half for a third time. So as long as what you're given is kind of friendly to be able to be, so you can cut it in half 3 times. You start at 200, cut it in half to get 100, cut it in half again to get 50, cut it in half again to get 25. So 200 divided by 8 is 25. So when you see things like that, you start thinking, okay, half, half, half. See if you can get the answer. All right, let's try another one. So 624 divided by 8. So remember, when I see divided by 8, I think half, half, half. I'm going to cut it in half once, cut it in half twice, cut it in half a third time. Half of 624 is 312. Then half of 312 156. And half of 156 gives me my final answer of 78. If you got 78, awesome. If you did it, just means you need to practice. And remember, you can do all of this in your head, even though I wrote it down, and you can write down and practice at first, but then really, you know, if you're a parent, maybe just start with something like 624 divided by 2 and see if they can find half, or 624 divided by 4 and see if they can cut it in half twice before you get to a third time. Okay? I know I gave you a divided by 16 on that worksheet, and I'll leave that up to you to practice. But if dividing by 8 is cutting it in half 3 times, then my question to you would be, what is dividing by 16 the same as? And that will allow you to do the page that's on your sheet. Okay? I gave you a little bit of a weird one here, 56 divided by 3.5. Now, in Mathnasium, a really great, the way we look at division and the way we teach it is, you know, how many of these are inside of that? So the question is, how many 3.5s are inside of 56? Which is kind of a weird question. But we've talked about in other lessons that I've done about how you can think about division as long as you do things in proportion, okay? Which means that if I change this to something that's a little more friendly for me to solve, I just have to, you know, if I have to adjust my answer, solving an easier problem sometimes will allow me to get at the answer of a harder one. So if I were to ask you what 56 divided by 3.5 is, it might be helpful for you to think about what 56 divided by 7 is. Now you might be asking, where did 7 come from? Well, what's the connection between 3.5 and 7? If I double 3.5, I get 7. Okay. Now, what I just asked you to solve 56 divided by 7, I didn't solve the original question. So now I have to figure out, do I need to make that bigger or smaller? And I actually have to make that answer bigger. If I double this, I also have to double this, which is kind of interesting to think about. Okay. My question is why? Would there be more 3.5s inside of 56 than there are 7s inside of 56? And the answer is yes, because 3.5 is smaller than 7. That means that there are more of them inside of 56. There are 16 3.5s inside of 56. So if I double this, I have to double my answer. Okay. So sometimes writing something as a problem that you're given is something that's a little friendlier that you know how to solve is really helpful. Okay. We've talked about that idea before. So if you joined me before, we've talked about it. This one's just a little bit different. Awesome. Okay. Now, I want to show you something else, I want to show you two things that are kind of fun. All right. One of them is something that if you are in elementary school, believe it or not, there was a time that I was in elementary school too. And when I was in elementary school, this was something I used to practice mentally all the time. It's what's called short division. Okay, now, the reason why I bring this up in mental math is because short division really allows you to think about division problems like this mentally. Because we know with long division, it's called long division because you show all your steps. You think about how many times, you know, 4 divides into 6, and then you subtract and how much is left over, and you bring the next number down, and that's something that you're working on. But short division allows me to do all of this mentally. So my first question to you, and the process is very similar. How many times does 4 change colors? How many times does 4 go into 6, and how much is left over? So there's 1 4 inside of 6, and with how many left over? With 2 left over. But instead of writing it down here, I'm holding this in my head, there's 2 left over. I'm going to write the 2 right there. Now the question is, how many times does 4 go into 25? There are 6 4s inside of 25 with 1 left over. And how many times does 4 go into 16? There are 4 4s in 16. Okay. So the way this works, and you can write this down until you're comfortable doing it mentally, is that all that computation is being done up in your head. How many times does 4 go into 6? Once with 2 left over. How many times does 4 go into 25? And you keep going that way. When you write it down, it looks like this. But in your head, you're holding this in your head, and you're also holding these little numbers in your head too. Okay? And when we do another mental math, if you join me again, we can practice that a little bit more. But instead of writing all of those steps down and bringing down the number, you're calculating and doing the subtraction in your head and all the division in your head, and you're just working away from left to right. Okay. One more really cool kind of math trick or shortcut. Okay. And it's I want to talk about how to multiply a number times itself that ends in 5 quickly. Okay. And maybe some of you are old enough, we call this squaring. So maybe some of you would think of this as being 45 squared, which you're absolutely right. And the way this, sometimes when you see this, it's how do you square a number that ends in 5 quickly? So whenever you're asked to do this, you write a 25, and you have to figure out what digits go before the 25. And the way you figure it out is you take this number and multiply it times one more than that number, and those digits go right there. So 45 times 45 is 2025. Think about how that works mentally. If I were to ask you what 45 times 45 is, okay, I know it ends in a 25. That first digit is 4, so that times one more than that digit is 20. There's a 20 before the 25. I get 2025. So here's one for you to try. What's 95 times 95? So remember, the result always ends in 25. You just have to figure out the digit or digits that come in front. So think about how you get that. It's always this digit times one more than that digit that goes right there. 95 times 95 is 9025. Does it work if you had a three-digit number? So 115 squared, remember that's the exact same as 115 times 115. So remember that the result always ends in 25. Sorry. What goes in front of the 25, it's these digits times one more than that digit. There you go. And I will be doing more mental math lessons. And when you join me again, I will show you how that works because we are out of time for today. So I will give you a little bit of a teaser for the next time we get together because it's always important to see how these things work instead of just learning shortcuts and tricks. And if you can figure out how it works, that would be even more awesome if you shared that in the comments the next time we got together. So I'm going to end it with that today. I really hope you enjoyed it. You know, Mathnasium, we spend a lot of time working on mental math and number sense. Our entire curriculum is built around the number sense techniques that we talked about today and how to extend them and move students beyond kind of pencil to paper computation, which is really important, but these things are important too. Like I said, it stretches their brain just a little bit. So, we are here every day, Monday through Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific. We will have another awesome lesson planned for you tomorrow. So I hope you join us. Follow us, like us, share it with all your friends, learn more about Mathnasium. And with all that, thank you so much for joining me. Bye.